no longer employed by the Oil and Gas Commission. We have three offices. Historically, El Dorado was the main office in Olivia and El Dorado. We have an office in Fort Smith, takes care of the gas producing area in the Arkoma Basin. Field goes by El Dorado. The Smackover Field has been referred to as the entire producing area of South Arkansas. The Smackover producers, that's incorrect. The Smackover Field is the formal name of this field just near Smackover. Some Smackover production occurs in that field that's primarily not Smackover. Smackover is a formation that goes throughout southern Arkansas and even other states. The production you see in the map is from the upper part of the Smackover formation. The Brown Dense, the new leasing, is occurring based on a part of the formation that's occurs below this producing horizon, deeper in the formation. If you go on our webpage, I'll briefly go through this, but those blue dots represent about 1.2 million barrels of production from the Smackover formation last year. How much the Brown Dense will add to that in the future is unknown, but that just lets you know what the Upper Smackover has produced during last year. All of that information, let's see if I get a cursor here. If you go on our webpage, where the cursor is an annual report of all the information on the producing horizons in Arkansas, how much each horizon is produced, is listed there in the annual report, as well as information on how many permits were issued, and the geologic information on each of the fields in South Arkansas. What I'm going to do now is I'll just do the intro, but we have two presentations. Alan York, one of our staff attorneys, will make a presentation first, followed by Shane Corey, who is our deputy director and general counsel on the lease provisions here in Arkansas.
Hold the microphone. How's that?
Better.
Okay.
Lean it against your chin.
The first thing that I want to start off doing is describing some of the things that the Arkansas Oil and Gas Commission does not do. Director Bangle just briefly went through some of the things that we do as an agency. One of the things that is presented to me most often, being one of the attorneys for the Oil and Gas Commission, is people want me to interpret their oil and gas lease for them. What I like to tell folks is a lease is just a contract. It's between two private parties, and it can say whatever those two parties can agree to. So we as an agency cannot interpret your oil and gas lease for you. You come into our office and bring your lease, I can't sit down and give you an opinion of what I think it means or how it's going to affect your interest. Our agency also cannot interpret landowner-operator agreements regarding surface use, etc. Nor can we determine whether or not something you negotiated is appropriate or not. Something that comes up with a fair amount of regularity is folks have an issue with their lease and they want us to determine whether it's valid or not. That goes back to the first topic that I was speaking on. We can't make a determination like that. That is the jurisdiction of the court system. That's just beyond what we're able to do. We also don't maintain records of mineral leases or mineral ownership. Oftentimes folks will call our office wanting to know the history of their mineral ownership or research whether or not they have a valid claim to the minerals, and that's just beyond what we keep records on. That's maintained with the county. The leasing process is pretty much universal. A mineral interest owner is approached by someone to lease their minerals. If you choose to lease your minerals, you negotiate and execute a contract with that company or that party. If you do not choose to lease your minerals, there is a process through the Oil and Gas Commission that's referred to as an administration that Mr. Corey is going to be speaking on a little bit later. What I want to go over tonight is just general information about the nuts and bolts of what make up an oil and gas lease, to give you a better idea of what some of those clauses may be dealing with and what's out there as far as what you can discuss or negotiate with whoever presents you with the lease. This is just a list, and I certainly don't want to read all these items off to you as we'll go through each one. The granting clause of a lease is what you give. And there's a lot of legalese up here. I wouldn't suggest you try to read it while I'm talking. It's just basically sample language that was pulled from the lease form that we had on hand. Granting clause is what you give as a mineral owner to that other party. It can decide what the scope of that is, what you're offering up. Is it just oil and gas? Is it oil, gas, and brine? Is oil, gas, brine, some other minerals? Once again, those are all matters that are subject to negotiation between the parties. You can determine what you give. You can also determine what you want to ask to get from the other side. The term clause is how long you're going to give those rights to the other party. Usually there are two terms when we speak about oil and gas leases. One is the primary term of the lease, which is set out usually in a matter of years. And then the secondary term of the lease, which is what comes into play if someone either establishes operations or production from that lease. What you take from an oil and gas lease is usually some type of bonus payment that's paid to you in lieu of your right to go out there and drill and produce your own minerals, and a royalty on production. The historical royalty has been 1/8. Folks, once again, that's a term you can negotiate. Oftentimes we'll see folks negotiate for more than 1/8. It's important also to realize that the terms for royalty can play out a little bit differently between oil and natural gas. I know in South Arkansas it's mostly oil that you're going to be dealing with, but South Arkansas also has the potential to produce natural gas. So that both of these clauses are important. An oil royalty clause is going to define what you take from the production of oil off that lease, how royalties are going to be calculated, basically. Natural gas royalty, much the same story, but a much different process that those payments are going to flow through. It's important to understand those whenever you're sitting down and negotiating a lease. If you do not have an understanding of how you're going to be paid, my usual suggestion is to seek out somebody who does understand those terms and describe what you're entering into. A shut-in clause is simply a clause in a lease that determines how the parties are going to act whenever there is a well that is capable of production on that lease or in that drilling unit that is not producing. Oftentimes, the operator of that well will have to pay what's referred to as a shut-in royalty for whatever period of time that well is capable of production and not producing. A pooling clause for a lease is simply a clause that says that the operator or whoever's conducting operations can pool your interest with the interest of others to create some type of drilling unit so that those parties may collectively share from production. In South Arkansas, I'll tell you that almost always that particular drilling unit is going to be based upon some geologic testimony and fact that's been presented to the Oil and Gas Commission. Proportionate production clause is a portion of the lease that deals with if you own less than 100% of your minerals, how your royalty or your share for that production is going to be diminished by your proportionate share. So if you own half the minerals, of course, you would only receive half the royalty for that mineral interest. And usually in every lease agreement, there's going to be assignment clauses about what the parties can and can't do about assigning their rights in that contract to someone else. Whether it's the operator assigning that to some other operator or some other company, or the mineral owner assigning their right to receive payment to someone else. surface issues clause is usually a give and take between the parties. If the mineral owner doesn't own the surface property, they may not really care about this clause. But if they do own the surface property, they'll probably enter into some type of negotiation with that operator regarding use of the surface. Generally speaking, when someone owns the minerals or leases the minerals underneath a piece of property, they have the reasonable right to go and produce those minerals or explore for those minerals. So oftentimes you'll see folks negotiating for how the surface is to be used regarding well placement or access, those types of situations. We spoke about the primary and the secondary term earlier. The continuous drilling, continuous operations clauses that are found in most oil and gas leases are dealing with what the operator of that well or whoever's leased the interest must do to continue that lease on beyond that primary term. So it could be operations, it could be actually drilling the well. Once again, that is a term that can be negotiated between the parties to what suits them both the best. Now we're getting into the portion of leasing terms that deal with what happens at the end of that contractual agreement, cessation of production. How's that lease going to end? Once again, that is a term that can be negotiated by the parties. And then, of course, surrender clause if one party or the other, well, the operator wants to get out of the agreement, they can always surrender it back to the mineral owner. Force majeure clause, that's just a French way to say superior force. This is usually something that I think of as akin to an act of God clause. There's something that has occurred that has been beyond the control of either one of those parties, and this clause addresses that and how that lease is to be treated if that situation arises. Something that we get questioned a lot on is title to minerals and people's issues that may arise regarding their ownership. Oftentimes you will find in leases that the person who's taking that lease and paying money for that lease wants some type of covenant title on that lease. They want to know that the title they're getting to those minerals are good, and the person that they've just written that check or that draft to is going to be responsible for that title if an issue arises. Adverse claims clauses deal with if someone or some entity makes a claim on the title or ownership of those minerals. This defines what parties are going to do as far as the operator or the person leasing the minerals versus the mineral owner and their responsibility for those situations as they arise. The release of dower and courtesy is the releasing of the rights that are inherent by law to husbands and wives just by the fact that they're married. Oftentimes, if just a husband or just a wife owns the minerals, someone will want a release of those dower courtesy rights by that spouse so that they don't face a claim later on if something were to happen, the husband or the wife were to pass away, and then that surviving spouse being able to make some claim regarding the ownership of those minerals beyond what may be set out either by law for intestate succession, what happens when you pass away without a will, or what may happen with a will. Successors and assigns clause, once again, this speaks back to the parties being able to have others come along behind them regarding their rights. This is a question that I get posed quite a bit. What should I do? As I said earlier, that's not something that we can tell you. We can't give you advice or opinion on what you should do or what you shouldn't do. I like to remind everyone that a mineral lease is on the terms that you and the leasing party agree upon. So long as you can both agree to it and it doesn't break the law, it can probably be a binding contract. And in a lease, you can address your specific concerns that you have. If you have concerns about well location or how the surface property is to be used, you can put that information in a lease. You can address use of water. You can address timber or crop damages. You you need to seek out legal advice or financial advice about what those clauses may impact your circumstances. A lot of times I also get asked, what happens if I wait and I don't do anything? Well, I try to speak in general terms, but you may get nothing. Oftentimes you'll find with the oil and gas play that comes along, there is a certain frenzy of leasing activity on the front end. Before the play has been proven to be productive or not. If you wait, that leasing opportunity may pass you by. If you wait and the play is proven to be a productive play and the interest continues, then you may be integrated by order of the Oil and Gas Commission, or the company that seeks to produce your minerals may request an integration of your interest by the Oil and Gas Commission. In South Arkansas, you also see a fair amount of receivership lawsuits where a party who seeks to produce a well will, in essence, sue the parties in that drilling unit so that they can produce those minerals, and then the court will receive their funds from production, and then they can petition the court for distribution. One of the benefits of the integration process through the Oil and Gas Commission is that it is a very regimented process. If someone applies to the Oil and Gas Commission for integration, they file an application. As soon as we can get it on the website, it's posted to our website. They're also required to send notice to all those parties that they seek to integrate. We will hold a public hearing, and the commission will take testimony and evidence regarding that request. They'll make a determination about that application. Some of the benefits there is that process is a known quantity. You know the requirements, or you can know the requirements of law of what those parties are required to do. You also have the benefit of a model lease form that was adopted by the commission in 2006 that the terms are known on. That's once again available 24 hours a day on our website. There is also a uniform joint operating agreement, both for the liquid hydrocarbon areas of South Arkansas, as well as one that's more often used in North Arkansas for natural gas production. At this point, I want to turn it over to our general counsel, Shane Corey. He's going to go through some sample lease documents as well as the integration process.
Good evening. As Mr. York said, my name is Shane Corey, and I'm Deputy Director and General Counsel for the Arkansas Oil and Gas Commission. The reason we decided to do this form was that we were getting a lot of questions and a lot of calls from this area of the state about the leasing activity regarding the Brown Dense specifically. We decided to do this basically just as a public service to let you know, and if you take nothing else out of tonight, take the fact that a lease is a voluntary agreement. You are free to negotiate most of those terms. There are a few of them that are minimum standards set by state law, but the bottom line is that these are voluntary documents, at least until the point there's either receivership or integration order of the commission. These are contracts that you're entering into, and make sure that you either are familiar with the lease that you're signing, or you might want to have someone go out and have a lawyer or somebody else or a landman or somebody help you read the lease and understand exactly it is that you're signing. I have up here on the screen, and I don't expect you to read these by any means, but just these are two different leases. One is the oil and gas lease that has been approved by the commission. This is used in our integration orders. And there's also a sample lease document that we came across. I blew up two specific provisions from each lease, and basically, I guess this would fall under the what you give clause that Mr. York described. As you can see, the main differences are highlighted in yellow. In the top lease, which is just a sample company lease form, you are giving interest in oil, gas, and other minerals specifically. In the bottom lease, which is the approved AOGC form lease, you're giving basically an interest in oil and gas only. So the top one is more of a, could be construed as a potential minerals lease as opposed to just an oil and gas clause. That's just one particular clause that I wanted to point out. As you read through different leases, they all say something different. So the point is, make sure you understand
once you get past the voluntary leasing option, basically the company has several options at that point. They can either use the court, a civil lawsuit, a receivership case, which has been used in South Arkansas, or they can file an application with the Arkansas Oil and Gas Commission for integration litigation. There's no mandate that they have to do that. And they can, in essence, turn around and go home if they don't get enough leases in there. So if you're waiting on an integration or receivership, it may or may not happen. It just kind of depends on how the play develops. For purposes of leasing and the integration process, I think it's important that you understand that there is a minimum royalty set by state law. The minimum royalty set by state law is a 1/8 royalty. So as we go through this, I'm going to refer to your royalty rate as 1/8, and we're going to refer to the other 7/8 of your interest as the working interest. That obviously can be negotiated in a lease. You can negotiate for a higher royalty, 3/16 royalty, a quarter, a fifth. Those are all rates that we see before the Oil and Gas Commission. If the company elects to use the Oil and Gas Commission, the first thing the Oil and Gas Commission is going to do, usually in conjunction with the integration application, is form a drilling unit. The purposes of forming a drilling unit are basically to protect the rights of all those parties that are involved, protect the reservoir from which you're producing oil and gas, prevent waste by overproduction, and establish an area for sharing the production proceeds. This picture up here is a picture from, I believe, Texas in the early 1900s. This was before there was regulation in establishment of drilling units. Basically, the old way was a law of capture, which in essence means whoever drilled the well got the oil out first, got to drill their well. So as you can see, if you drilled a well, your neighbor drilled a well, and whoever produced it got to keep the oil. There were lots of problems associated with that. You know, you could drain someone else's oil, and you could harm the reservoir by producing oil too fast and basically trapping it in the ground. So most states in the 1930s, give or take, started establishing oil and gas commissions or some type of regulatory agency that had the power to create drilling units and establish spacing for rules. On the screen is just a typical drilling unit. Basically, it can vary in size. It can be 10 acre, 20 acre, 40 acre, 60, 80, 160, 640 acre unit. The Arkansas statute at this point in time says that a drilling unit is to be 640 acres, more or less, unless another size is developed by the Arkansas Oil and Gas Commission. So the commission, after hearing evidence, typically decides what the appropriate size of a drilling unit is based on the evidence that's presented. So in the center of the box is basically, I guess, call it the teal area. That's a completion area. That's where you're allowed to drill your well. The red area is a setback. That is basically to protect. You cannot drill a well within that red area. The purpose of that is to protect the owners that would be on the other side of the drilling unit line. So why integration? Why have a process that forces you to make a decision? Well, basically to protect everyone's rights, to make sure that everyone is going to get their fair share of production that is allocated to them from the drilling unit. Also to protect the reservoir and prevent waste. If a company elects to use the integration process, they're going to file an application with the Arkansas Oil and Gas Commission. They're going to give you notice. They're going to schedule a hearing. The commission's going to meet. It's usually the fourth Tuesday of the month, sometimes the fourth Tuesday of Wednesday. They'll have a hearing. The commission will make a determination. If the integration application is approved, we as staff will go back and write an order, issue the order. If you're a party to that order, you'll get a copy of it. And that order will give you 15 days to make an election. And it'll specify what your elections are in that order. Typically, they contain four options. Once you're integrated, you have four options. You can affirmatively elect a lease with either another company if you wanted to within that 15-day period, or you can elect to lease with the company that integrated you using the Oil and Gas Commission form lease. You can do nothing, and there'll be a default option that tells you which one the lease is. You can elect to participate, or you can elect non-consent. And I'll explain participation and electing non-consent in just a few slides here. Most of the time, if you choose to do nothing during the time period, like 95, 96%, 100% of the time, your default option is going to be deemed lease using the terms of the oil and gas model for lease or deemed integrated. 5% of the time, if there's a well capable production unit, there is a portion of the law that basically says that instead of being deemed lease, you're deemed to elect non-consent, and then to offset that, the commission oftentimes sets a 100% risk factor penalty, and that risk factor penalty will make more sense in this model. So what's the difference between electing the lease and doing nothing under the default option? Well, based on the commission's interpretation, under both instances, the commission is going to set the cash bonus per acre you're going to get. Most of the time, that is set by testimony that provides what the highest and best that's been paid in the particular unit is. The commission hears that testimony, the applicant is required to give that to us, and then they decide what it should be. Like I said, probably 99% of the time, it's the highest and best that's been paid, unless there's some unusual circumstance. And the commission also sets the royalty amount, whether it's 1/8 or something higher. That's also based upon what the highest that's been paid. If you sign a lease, then you are affirmatively granting certain rights to that operator, the rights of ingress and egress, or the right to, for them to enter and come upon the land, the right to construct pipelines or other facilities. If you don't do anything, if you do nothing and you're deemed integrated or deemed leased, and you own 100% of the minerals underneath your surface, it is the commission's position that you have not granted any service rights to the operator. So in essence, if you own all 40 mineral acres of your 40-acre tract, and you're integrated, and the default option is deemed integrated, and you don't sign anything in the 15-day time period, you'll still get your cash bonus and royalty according to the order, but you haven't granted any access to the property to the operators. That is, I think, a long-standing precedent or opinion of the commission. It has never been challenged in court. Other states kind of go both ways. Like I said, our position is you haven't agreed. The problem is if someone else owns a portion of your minerals underneath your surface, so if you only have a half interest in your minerals, or you don't have the interest at all, by that other person signing a mineral lease, they have granted the operator the right to come on your property and do whatever they're allowed to do under the terms of the lease. So if you're relying on integration and not doing anything to basically, in essence, give you a kind of a no surface clause, make sure you know whether you own all your minerals or not. All right, the other two options that were in the order, you can elect to participate. This basically means you're going to become the full partner in the land. You're going to have to pay your percentage for the drilling completion costs. You're going to receive your percentage of the revenue. In essence, you're going to receive your 1/8 royalty plus your 7/8 work interest. If you elect non-consent, it's kind of a hybrid of the two. You're not going to get a cash bonus. You are going to be entitled to 1/8 minimum royalty. That's all it's going to be. And in essence, after the company recoups its investment in their well for your share of the land, 4 to 6 times, depending on what is said by the commission, you come in as a partner at that point. So basically, how that works is the company puts up the money for your share of being an owner or participating party. They recoup their money and then you come in as an owner without having to put any money in front. A lot of people think that's a great idea and it sounds good. The only problem is, and I always warn people of this, it works in theory unless if the well never pays out, you never come in as a partner. Or, worst case scenario, I guess, the well pays out. Means the operators recoup their money 4 to 6 times. You're now in as a full owner, and something happens to the well, and the well has to be plugged, then you may receive a bill from your share of plugging, but you're a full owner at that point in time. Hopefully to help make this a little more clear, I'm using an example. This example is based on a Fayetteville Shale well. So it's a 640-acre unit. And for this example, we're going to assume you own 160 acres. The Brown Dense, I don't even know if we're at the point to know whether it's all oil or oil and gas. So for purposes of this example, just remember this is only a gas producing well in this example. A typical gas producing well, the Fayetteville Shale, costs anywhere from $2.5 to $4 million. So if you're going to participate and you own 160 acres of that 648 drilling unit, you're basically going to have a share that's going to be 160, your amount of acres, divided by 640, the total amount of the acres of the unit. So if you want to participate, assuming it's a $3 million well, you're going to have to put up $750,000 in front. If you're going to go non-consent, in essence, the company puts up that $750,000 for you, you will receive one acre. And then if the company receives its money back, in this particular case, we're going to say 400% risk benefit increase. Once the company, or if the company receives its money back four times, then you would come in as a part of that. So the company has to pay the money. If the well reached a point where it paid the company back $3 million, you would come in as a partner. And like I said, at that point in time, you're a full partner. So the well's to be plugged the next day, or shortly thereafter, you're liable for any costs, your operating costs of that well, or your share of the costs of that well. This is just kind of give you an example of taking, if you were just a lease on a 160-acre unit, and the next slide I'll go through participation. So same example, you own 160 acres and a 640-acre unit. You lease at a 1/8 royalty. So in order to determine your, basically, your monthly rate, you do a simple formula where you take your royalty, which in our hypothetical is a 1/8 royalty, divided by your number of acres in the unit, times the price and volume. Now, the price and volume that we're using here, like I said, is gas, not oil, so it would be a little different for oil. But if you're assuming $4 per MCF gas and a well producing 500 MCF per day of gas, then your royalty rate for that month comes out to be $1,875. So if you lease, you've got your cash bonus up front and an average of $1,875, at least for the month in our example. If you were to participate, in addition to that $1,875, you would also get your 7/8 working interest. So using the same formula, $4 gas, a well producing 500 MCF a day, you in essence would come up with an additional $13,125 per month, minus your monthly operating costs. That would be in addition to your $1,875 1/8 royalty portion. But to get that $15,000, remember you had to pay $750,000 up front with no guarantees that the well was going to produce. Dry hole, something like that, and you've lost your investment. So the same math here works for if you're a non-consent owner, you get your $1,875 per month. You wouldn't get this until if the well ever paid out 4 to 6 times and you come in there. The laws that govern this process and statutes are our administrative rules. If you want to look them up, they're listed on the screen. There's Arkansas Code annotated 1572, 302, 303, 304, and then specifically commission rules, general rules 82 and 83. That's about all I have for the integration process. I have a website up here. If you can see across the top, there are some yellow drop-down bars. The third one over says mineral surface owner info. Put your mouse on that, it'll drop down the menu. It has an Arkansas leasing manual, rights and conflicts among surface owners, royalty surface owner brochure, and a copy of the surface owner notice statute. The Arkansas leasing manual is a very comprehensive, manual on leasing. It was written by an attorney out of Texarkana. It's got sample lease clauses. It explains all the clauses in detail that Mr. York went over. And like I said, it even has sample clauses in there for you to use if you have a certain particular thing you're worried about, for example, water use or how close a well can be from a dwelling or a structure on your property, things like that. The royalty service owner brochure is it's a fairly short overview of the integration process and the leasing process. I know it's duck season. Then right, and the other two are just, you know, like I said, one's a statute, another one's another manual that kind of explains all this. So there's plenty of information out there. If you want to take the time and learn, we try to include a fairly comprehensive selection of information on our webpage. I guess that concludes our formal presentation. I'll open it up to questions, and I guess since I'm up here, I'll answer them or give them to the direct legal if there's something that they should answer. Do we have any questions? Yes, sir.
If I don't lease to Triad or Pine Belt and I'm forced into the pool, what are my options?
If you, the question is, if you don't lease to Triad or Pine Belt, what are your options?
Well, yeah, what are the options? Be forced into the pool.
The options for Triad or Pine Belt are to possibly do a receivership, as Mr. York talked about, which is done through the court system, or to use the integration process. If it comes to the point of the integration process, then you would get notice of the hearing. There would eventually be an order. If the commission approved it, you would get an order giving you those options I just described, one of those four options. Lease, do nothing, participate, go non-consent. And it'll also have a default clause in case you fail to make an election within the time frame set by the commission. So basically, if you're integrated, you'll eventually have to make a decision on, do you want to participate? Do you want to elect non-consent? Do you want to voluntary the lease or do nothing and probably be deemed integrated or leased?
They're going to penalize you 400 to 600% if you don't.
No, that 400 to 600% only applies to the non-consent portion. So if you affirmatively elect non-consent,
okay.
All right. Then you're going to get a 1/8 royalty rate.
Why does Arkansas have that and Louisiana don't have it? I've got family that's in homes in Union County and Claiborne Parish, and they can participate in Claiborne and not be penalized.
Well, you can elect to participate and not be penalized. The 400 to 600% only applies if you elect this one option of non-consent.
Carry working interest.
And carry your working interest. And for them paying, carrying your working interest, they get to recoup their money 4 to 6 times, or whatever amount is set by the commission, typically 4 to 6 times. But you can elect to participate. There's no 400 to 600% risk factor penalty, but you have to pay your own working interest up front. So you can elect to participate, pay your share, be a partner all day long, but you have a third option, which is kind of a hybrid of leasing and participating, but there's also some risk associated with it. Next question. For example, take the Fayetteville Shell thing. When the Fayetteville Shell first started, it was thought to be a lot bigger than it actually turned out to be. So there are counties, what we call the abatement, that where cash bonuses were paid if you leased. Some people held out for integration, never got paid. So that's the only risk you may run. But in terms of integration, it is part of the rules require the operator to try to contact the commission. It is basically a way to protect all the owners in the unit, make sure everyone gets paid. But there, it's not even adversarial. It is, I'm the applicant, I go to the commission, I say, I can't lease these people, I need to drill a well in here. The commission hears the application, sets the cash bonus and royalty. Like I said, most of the time it is the highest and best that's been paid in that particular unit. So, you know, assuming they integrate your unit, you have nothing to lose necessarily by waiting. The only risk you have is if they never integrated it or the brown dense turned out to not go anywhere, which I don't know anybody to tell you what it's going to do right now or what unit size is going to be or anything like that. You know, then there's that risk there.
Another thing is we only issue a 1-year lease.
Yeah, the beginning I showed you the two different lease forms. I told you about one particular clause. The another distinction between the AOTC approved model form lease and lease forms used by companies, the standard primary term for the oil and gas commission lease is a one-year term. When you're negotiating with companies, that can be as long as you want it to be, and oftentimes those leases are 3 or 5 year primary terms. Yes, sir. Well, to be honest, you know, so many different company forms are out there, it's hard to say, well, this company, this provision is different. I can tell you that the standard clause of oil and gas commission lease is a one-year primary term lease. The cash bonus and royalty is set by the commission based upon the highest investments paid in that unit. It's limited to oil and gas or other associated substances with oil and gas. It doesn't include other potential minerals like brine and lignite or anything like that. It's strictly oil and gas. It specifies, it is in essence somewhat of a, somewhat of a cost for these certain expenses they are not allowed to deduct under the oil and gas commission. Provisions to allow certain facilities, but I don't remember which ones those are. I think it allows drilling pits.
It can only be freshwater, it can't be saltwater.
I think our best recollection is it's going to be a freshwater drilling pit that will be authorized by our lease. There are other rules and regulations by us and the DEQ. Some of those pits are no longer allowed anyway, but I'd have to review the lease to be a specific answer. Yes, sir.
Family just got an interest in Cleveland Springs field. We got one well out there producing 5 barrels a day that I saw. And they're not going to drill anymore or nothing. They got this land tied up for almost 40 years, over 6,000 acres. Why can't they release some of that to the mineral owners and let them release it to other companies to where they drill and start producing from it?
Well, as some of you are aware, because y'all have that here, the commission had a hearing. In essence, determined that Cleveland Springs operator has complied with the operating agreement. Now, there was some testimony given by the operator and what they were going to do at that particular hearing, and we and staff, at the direction of some of the commissioners, are following up with them to see what they're going to do. But at the time we had the hearing last year, it was in essence the operator had complied with the provisions of their operating agreement, at least at that point in time. Ultimately couldn't do anything about it because they hadn't applied with their operating
agreement. Was their time about run out on that?
What's that?
Was their time about run out on trying to do what you're going to do and not do nothing?
Well, like I said, we've contacted the operator recently to see what they've done just based on the testimony that the new operator gave to the commissioners to see, what they were going to do and what they were going to follow up on. But at this point, at least at the point of the hearing last time, they complain that they're operating.
Well, I know it's 25% of people didn't even sign the lease to begin with 37 years ago. And they're wanting part of their stuff released where they can, you know, get some money out of it instead of 5 barrels a day.
I understand.
Well, the provision needs to change it or something about it.
Well, the problem with units, voluntary, you know, units that are formed at one point in time, just like if you're into a contract now, and those contracts last. So your heirs and successors are bound by those contracts.
Not trying to do anything. They could, just like the commission could encourage them to release it.
Which is why we're investigating and following up with them right now. But at least as of last year when we had the hearing, there was nothing we could do. But we will continue to work on that and follow up. Some of our commissioners, gentlemen behind you, are making sure that we follow up on that as well. So.
I'd like to say the reason we're here is what Deputy Director Corey said is when the Fayetteville Shale started, but the cursor was 3,000 wells. 4 years ago, or 5 years ago now, there was not one well. 7 years? Time flies when you have fun. 7 years ago, there was not one well drilled in the Fayetteville Shale area. In 7 years, 3,800 wells were drilled that play. During the initial several years, we held as a commission 30 town hall type meetings throughout the Fayetteville Shale area and down into the embayment area where my cursor is, where the leasing frenzy was occurring. During that time, we tried to educate everyone to the provisions of leasing and the geology of the Fayetteville Shale, what they could expect in the future. The Brown Dense to date in South Arkansas, which is probably going to occur in the hatched area up there, has not yet to date produced any commercial quantities of oil. There have been two test wells. One test well has produced some oil. So we are early on in development of the Brown Dense, and should occur here in South Arkansas. It is now in the leasing phase. So our goal is, if we need to hold more of these meetings to help the public understand what's going on and what the extent of the issue is. South Arkansas, unlike the Fayetteville Shale, is not unaccustomed to leasing. But the Brown Dense is going to be a little bit different in that the potential for production will occur probably outside of the historical producing area fields because of the nature of the Brown Dense being a reservoir that can produce where coal fields are not existing now. There'll be horizontal well drilling. It'll be fracturing similar to the Fayetteville Shale. And so areas not accustomed to leasing in this part of the state may be approached for that purpose. So our goal is to get ahead of the curve and provide as much information as possible to the public on what they can expect, what will be happening. Everything we talked about tonight, what we'll do is right here under the Fayetteville Shale information where my cursor is, even though there are brochures going through everything we talked about tonight, we will post these PowerPoints on our webpage also, so you can look at the exact. The mineral surface owner info will post both of these PowerPoints so you have access to what we exactly said here tonight. You can download those and look at them at your leisure. So that information will be up there. Oh, www. AOGC.state.ar.us.
Google AOGC.
Just Google AOGC, Arkansas Oil and Gas Commission, and it'll come up. That's all we have. No further questions. We'll stand here and wait for more questions.
Now, the question is, if you're in lease negotiations with specifically Triad or any other operator, does the Oil and Gas Commission help with that process? And the answer is no. We are a regulatory agency. Like I said, it's a voluntary lease option. You may want to contact a private attorney or someone who's familiar with oil and gas leases. We do provide general information on our website. We give you general information about leasing, but we can't get into specifics on private contracts.
But then if you don't agree, that can come to you and be integrated.
You can be integrated if the commission...
We'll help them integrate us.
Well, the integration form will not be the Triad lease form. It would be a lease form that has been established by the commission, and at least we think is a very fair and reasonable lease. So you know what you're getting with that, and like I said, we're going to try to help everybody understand and understand what you're signing. We have those brochures. We have attorneys that are willing to give you general information, but it's like any other private contract. You're negotiating for the sale of a house, the real estate commission can't really advise you on what terms to put in your specific contract. We are a regulatory body set up by the legislature of the state, and we have specific powers and duties in negotiating leases. A company can negotiate leases as well as those that need to allocate. Yes, sir. Chad, you want to use the mic up there? Bell?
What do you think? Oh, can I hear you?
Do you want to hear your
wind?
Everybody else
is talking. You're from here. If you're integrated, it's a wholly different form of these things than what Triad's proposing or somebody else is proposing to be this one.
But I think what you're asking is what happens if they bring you before the commission. Is that what you're asking?
No, what I'm asking is, if I disagree with Triad and I can't come to agreement with them, then they're going to come to the Arkansas Oil and Gas and start the integration process, which will go by the Arkansas Gas guidelines. What I'm saying, before they do that integration process, is there something that the Oil and Gas can do to step in to help with the negotiation process?
We cannot do that. We can do is after the integration process starts.
So after the integration, is there something the oil and gas can do to help so that the rules and the terms that I personally
no.
can't do anything with that?
No, I don't think you. But if they integrate you, you're going to get the best deal that they've given anyone else, and it's going to be for 1 year rather than the 3 years. So that's a little bit of an advantage.
Is
tell you what, I don't want to interrupt y'all's discussion because I think there's a valid point in place for discussion on fracking. I think what you're going to find in Arkansas is that we've done multiple water well tests, and we as well as the community have not found any instances of contamination on fracking drinking water supplies. But the point of this, back to your original question, what else can we do to help people negotiate? And that's our whole point of being here tonight, is to inform you that there are different lease forms, there are different provisions, that what you're doing is a voluntary process, it's a private contract right now. There's not a regulatory component until there's integration. So if you voluntarily enter into these contracts, make sure that you're knowledgeable and that you understand what you're signing. And that's what we're trying to do right now, is basically public awareness to help people out prior to the integration process.
I got another question.
I was going to say, with respect to fracking, unfortunately, Brown Dense, if you were to put that clause in your lease and the company were to agree to it, they couldn't produce the Brown Dense. That's probably what's going to happen. Fayetteville Shale is the same way. It's part of the completion strategy. A drilling permit is good for 6 months.
6 months. The reason I'd ask you...
It can be renewed after 6 months, but it's good for 6 months at a time.
That well down there in Union County, the horizontal well, the J&W operating company is supposed to drill, and the location's been cleared for 3 months, and they ain't set up nothing down there. I just wondered if they had a time limit on that.
Well, they have to commence drilling within 6 months. I don't know what the time frame is, but they have 6 months to spud the well. Or they can renew permanently, but the permit has to be renewed every 6 months if they don't get any drilling better.
The same way out here to Atlanta Field, they got a horizontal out there, but they're waiting to try it, supposed to do it, but they're trying to find out who owns the triad that's putting up all the money. And they had never found out yet, have they?
No, there was a hearing before the commission, triad. Established a drilling unit, the commission approved the establishment of the drilling unit, but put a caveat that we would not issue a drilling permit until there was another hearing before the commission. I don't know if that's going to occur in July or August at this point, but we don't know at this point, and we will not issue a drilling permit until that hearing occurs. But it'll be good for 6 months. Further questions? Pretty much the bulk was the south half of Union, Columbia, the portions of southern Lafayette and even Miller County. But like I said,
south half of Union all the way up to Nashville.
Over into Miller. But that's just what I've heard and read, so I can't verify that personally. No further questions, we'll give your opinion up to you if I'm asking personal questions if you want, but thank you.